So without much further ado, my sincere apologies to the audience and Dr. Seiko for all the technical issues we've had. So I won't take up any more time and we'll get right to it. So thank you for joining and thank you to the audience for being patient once again. So this is our ninth conference in this particular series on farm laws. And Dr. Jagroop Singh Seiko, who's a professor at Guru Nanak Dev University, Amritsar, Punjab, has joined us today. And we thank him for that. Dr. Seiko obtained his MPhil and PhD degrees from Guru Nanak Dev University, Amritsar, after starting an academic career at the Government College, Hoshiarpur, 1986. He joined the Department of Political Science, Guru Nanak Dev University, Amritsar, in January of 1989, and was promoted professor in 2006. He was head of the Department of Political Science from July 2003 to June 2006, and July 2013 to September 2019. He was also the head of the Department of School of Social Sciences from July 2013 to June 2016. He also served the university in various capacities, including Director of All India Services Pre-Examination Center from April 2010 to 2012, Director Capacity Enhancement Program of the University from August 2012 to March 2016, Professor in Charge of Examinations from April 2016 to 2017, and Directorate of Evening Studies from October 2018 to December 2019. He was a member of various academic and administrative bodies of different universities, boards, commissions, including the Member Planning and Monitoring Board of the Gandhigaram Rural Institute, deemed university in Tamil Nadu. He is a state coordinator of the Lok Nithi Program for Comparative Democracy Center for the Study of Developing Societies, Delhi, since 2007, and was the coordinator of the SAP UGC in the Department of Political Science 2014-2018. He was also the editor of the Punjab Journal of Politics, a biannual research journal of the Department of Political Science being published regularly since 1977. He served as Dean, Faculty, Arts, Social Sciences, and member of the Senate and Syndicate of Guru Nanak Dev University 2017-2018 and 2018-2019. Professor Seiko's major contribution is in the field of empirical research on various issues, political economy, terrorism, social and political movements, border areas, election studies, etc. He has written and published more than 60 papers and chapters in leading journals, books in India and abroad. He has successfully guided 8 doctoral scholars and another 4 students who are working under his guidance. One Fulbright scholar from the US worked under his guidance for her research work in India during the 2013-2014 term. He has also supervised more than 20 MPhil students. He has completed 3 major research projects, 2 founded by the UGC entitled General Elections 2009, a behavioral study of political attitudes and opinions in Punjab and the Union Territory of Chandigarh. And 2, Life at the Cutting Edge, Political Sociology of People Living in the Border Belt of Punjab, one by ICSSR entitled Problems of the Border Area Farmers in Punjab, an empirical study, and 1 minor project of the UGC on political sociology of religious sects in Punjab. He has also completed about 24 collaborative field work projects on various, including state farmers in Punjab, state of democracy in Punjab, state of nation survey, youth and religion, election studies, in collaboration with the Lok Nithi Program for Comparative Democracy, Center for the Study of Developing Studies, Delhi. He has participated in India and abroad in various live discussions in TV, radio, and social political issues. Professor Seiko is a life member of various academic associations, including the Indian Political Economy Association, Indian Political Science Association, and is a founder member of the Northwest Indian Sociological Association. So it's a pretty lengthy bio of Dr. Seiko, and thank you for joining. And before we start, please everyone mute. If there's time at the end of his presentation, you could personally ask questions. Otherwise, I'll moderate the questions. If you can raise your hand, unmute, and then ask questions. So without much further ado, once again, thank you. And the floor is yours, Dr. Seiko.
Thank you very much, sir, for giving me this opportunity to have interaction with Hugh and dialogue on the issue which is going on in India at present. May I speak in Punjabi also?
If you'd like, but our audience is the entire US, yeah. So that's one of the reasons we're trying to keep it in English, so it's the wider audience.
Yeah. So I start my talk with because today there are two important days which we are celebrating here. First is the birthday, 400th birthday of Guru Tegh Bahadur Sahib, who's known as a Hindi Chadar. And the second is that it's a World Labor Day in India. That is the first way, 2021. I start my this talk with that firstly, giving my tribute to more than 350 farmers who sacrificed their life during this farmers' agitation, farmers' movement in the country, which has become basically, it's not only confined to the Punjab or the national level, but it has become basically is being discussed all over the world. So that's why this farmer movement is going to create a history in that way also. So the reason of it is that first the focus is here is on that the current ongoing farmers movement and its impact on the society, the polity, and the people over here in India. We all know that India is an agrarian society, and more than the 50% of the total population is still dependent on the agriculture. And agriculture is already was going through a serious crisis because of the structural problems which resulted out of the path of the development which the country adopted after the post-independence India. And particularly in case of the Punjab, we have seen that Punjab is known as the granary of the country, and almost a two-third population is dependent upon agriculture in the state of the Punjab. And Punjab is the mainstay of agriculture, being that being a border state, that industrial development could not take place over here. So it's only basically the agriculture which is the main, what is the sources of livelihood of a large section population of the state over there. And this, we know that the whole problem, this issue started with, before coming to that, the issue which we are going to discuss is that, if you go by the agriculture scenario in this country, the last survey, this agriculture took place in 2015-2016. And overall at India level, we have seen that 50% population, as I said, that is dependent on agriculture, and agriculture is the only major source which has is a livelihood, source of the livelihood of the population of this country. And the structure of this agrarian system is that more than almost 85% of the total peasant in this country have a small or a marginal farmers. Means that they have less than 5 acres of the land over there. So having this much of a land is already becoming what we see there is. It's not what we see is that viable for a good livelihood, leave side of this dignified livelihood. So point is that when we have this, the nature and the structure of the agriculture is like that, that the dependence of the livelihood of the that much of population is on this agriculture. And when these three laws came into being, it basically raised many issues related to the very survival of the already marginalized, already excluded large population of the country because of these things. The second is that we go by that the agrarian structure over there, there are various other challenges which we are facing in the sense that reason being is that the farmers are not that what we see then farmers include what is that those do not have the land, who are dependent upon the land. Say for example, that agriculture workers are also part of this agrarian structure over there. So when we discuss the who is the peasant in that way, also the peasant in the particularly in the simplest possible way is that the peasant is that who is a dependent on whose survival is dependent on the agriculture or agriculture related activity. It means that almost a two-third of the total population in the country is dependent upon the agriculture. Their livelihood is dependent on the agriculture, who are directly or indirectly dependent upon that. And this particularly, when we see that in India, we have about 28 states now, and 18 states, which are basically the majority of the population, is dependent on this agriculture. And the agriculture is also dependent on, is not dependent on the nature, in the sense that only the 40% of the total area under cultivation has the ensured irrigation. If we leave that the Punjab and the Haryana and the parts of the UP out of that, it's only in the case of the Punjab where more than 90% population is dependent on that. So this was the situation in the country of the agriculture. But with the coming of these three, but the laws over there which were enacted by the government, firstly it came in the form of what we see, the June ordinances. So from the day one, this issue with the farmer agitation is that the way this whole issue was brought into the larger domain was that it is also the manifestation of the politics and the policies, particularly which we are witnessing in this country for the last, though this process began about 30 years ago when the liberalization and this process began, but particularly for the last 6-7 years, we are witnessing that the whole focus has been shifted to that a different type of a development model, with the ultimate aim is that how to open a way for what we see that the entry of the big farmers or the organizations or the big farmer houses into the agriculture. Because the very purpose of this one is that which we have seen that large population is there, and this is the occupation which is being, what we see is that dependence of large number of population is there. So this policy was came into the name of that the whole is to open the gate for that the local what big houses in that system. So point here is that when we see that agriculture scenario is already passing, as I told, that was in a crisis. We have seen that for the last 10 years, the farmers who at one point of time, particularly before independence or after independence, everyone at the forefront of all types of movements over there, situation has reached to that miserable level. A beginning of new development in the form of a commitment of the suicide by the farmers. So that type of withdrawal, that type of helplessness, that type of hopelessness was ultimately very much visible over there. And on the other side, when we see that the whole structure of fixing the prices, though we have, because agriculture played a very important role, not only for the economic development of the country. We know that when the country got independence, what was the scenario of the food grain situation over country? What was the, we are totally dependent upon the other countries for the basically a fulfillment of the food requirements over there. 60 was the most difficult stage for a decade for India. When we had to go to the United States of America and we had that BL 480, it was not only the economic, it was not only the social issue. There was a warning from the various corners. In case this problem, this food problem was not resolved, there's a possibility of very a strong resistance to the system over there. So ultimately, then this whole process of what is called the Green Revolution came over there, and we see now that within 3-5 years, ultimately, we became a self-sufficient in the food grain, and it resulted into the beginning of a good political decade in the 1970s. So once we have a food grain sufficiency, the political stability became quite eminent. We have seen in the 1970s, the way India intervened in the international affairs, particularly in case of the Pakistan issue, then went going to the underground nuclear explosion and so on and so forth. So point here is that the role of the agriculture sector played in the development of the country on the one side, the political stability of the country on the other side, at the cost of what we have seen, that at the cost of their land, at the cost of their climate deterioration, at the cost of what we see is that of their health and so on and so forth. So ultimately, this paved a new path of the development in the country. Though we all know that in Punjab, when the Green Revolution came into being, and the Green Revolution could not sustain for a longer period, because after in the 1970s, we see that a different movement came in the state. And after that, in the 1980s, there was a decline of the agriculture. And from there, we can see that there was a crisis, there was a stance in the whole agriculture basically development process over there. So we are already passing through this process. We are already going through this process. Agriculture was already quite strained in that way also. And because of there was a mismatch in the what we see that the input cost on the other side and the what they used to get as an output cost of their producer in the, so already difference was very much there because the input cost was left to the market economy and the output cost, particularly the output, the farmers, whatever we have the ensured minimum purchase from the government, that was also left to the market. So in this background, when we see that the already crisis was there, already movements were going on, and this government brought three laws on the name of the welfare of the government. Firstly, these were brought through the ordinance, and I'm not, since we don't have much time in that, we also to go that the whole process was what we see that arbitrary. The whole process was based on what we see that what they thought is right. In this row, stakeholder was taken into consideration. No consultation was taken place over there. The state, the country was facing through a very serious crisis of the pandemic. There was a total lockdown in the country. So in this way, these three bill, what we is called as a controversial bills, and which became the basis of what we are witnessing is one of the very powerful, one of the very strong, unprecedented farmers movement going on in the country. And these three laws that we see that if we go by the laws of which are enacted by the government, it seems to be very catchy. And if we just see that the title of these laws, for example, the Farmers Produce Trade and Commerce Promotion and Facilitation Bill, as these are going coming in the coming to the rescue of the farmers to, and the logic was given that this will help to strengthen the farming community. This will help to increase their what we see is the bargaining power. This will help to increase their income. But when we go by the structure of the peasantry over here, we have one study on the state of the farmers in the country 2013, where we have come to know that on all counts, the peasantries, the farmers, not only in Punjab but all over the India, they are very much excluded from the development process. Maybe it may be an economic development process, may it be a social development process, maybe any other development process, in the sense that I'll just give you one example. The first thing, as it's in the public domain, that the farmers, the level of the awareness of the farmers was very low. Particularly the schemes are being made, but all the schemes, the benefit of all the schemes are not being appropriated by the farmers as a whole. They are being appropriated by the middleman. Maybe they are in a market, maybe they are a part of the political system, and so on and so forth. When we see that, even the basic one example I want to bring to your kind notice is that the basic thing is that, okay, how much literacy the peasantry farmers are there. We have seen that in 2011, according to that census, the overall literacy in the country is of the 75%. 25% are non-literate. But when you see the non-literacy among the farmers, it's more than a 28-29%. And it was very surprising for us that it was more than a 32-33% in Punjab. So whatever the policies are there, what are the propagandas are there, what are the programs are there, the government which is saying that we have this much of a program, we have this much of a, what we see is the development schemes are there. Farmers either are not aware of that. Even if they are aware of that, they could not get the benefit of that. I will just give you one example that during the Manmohan Singh's government, there was a farmers waiving, there was a scheme of the waiving of the loans of the farmers. I think it was a very small number of the farmers in the Punjab who became, who got the benefit of that, because the large part of the loans is being, we have a parallel system, what is called as a informal structure of loaning, informal structure of what is called the indebtedness, and so on and so forth. So my point here is that the law which they enacted this government firstly the ordinances, then passing in a very controversial basically ways, as no proper discussion has been taken place, it was not being sent to the select committee, and so on and so forth. So ultimately this raised a serious what we see the concern among the farmers. So they became basically, they were already going through all difficult times. So once they came to know that, that the government is going to pass these laws only to benefit what we see is that the corporates over there, because the laws ultimately, which if you go by the law, they say that the farmers have the bargaining power. Where is the bargaining power in that way? When we go by in the practical way, a person having a 3 acre of a land or 5 acre of a land or a 10 acre of a land or a 6 acre of a land, on the other side, you have a corporates, you have a big, what is the farmers organizations over there. So how they will be able to bargain with the bargaining is always with between and among the equals. But in this, the structure which they have created, the bills which they have passed, or the propaganda which they are making that these farmers are basically, the three laws are basically to benefit the farmers, to what we see, the increase the income of the farmer, or to make them free from what is called that, from the local money lenders and so on. So ultimately, they are again pushing them into that system from where they, it's not possible for them to come back. So ultimately, when all these things were being came into the public domain, it was the farmers of the Punjab, firstly, they reacted to the passing of these bills in the sense that Punjab has a very, what we see that is a very a golden history of the peasants movement in this country. So since the immemorial days, we have seen that the peasant movement during the British period, even during the Mughal period, before that, or even after the post-independent India. So ultimately, there is the banner. These are the bill which came, which was brought by the central government. These are not only just going to take away not only of their livelihood, but also it's going to take away their very survival in the coming days, because they are very well aware in case these three bills are passed, in case these the free entry to the market is being given over there, in case they seize whatever the little protection they have in the form of the MSP. Let me underline it, even the government has agreed, even our, that study has come to that conclusion, only the 6 to 10% of the farmers are getting the insured minimum support price. And out of that, the maximum number is from the Punjab and the Haryana and the Western UP. In the rest of the country, we see that the farmers are not getting even the minimum support price, though the government fixes the minimum support price. So there is a huge gap. What the government says and what is the experience of the farmers at the grassroots level or the ground level. They are already basically pushed toward the wall, and they had no other option except to basically raise this issue or raise this banner or raise this what is called as the struggle, or to mobilize the people to fight against these what we call as three laws, which has become the central point of the ongoing the peasants movement. And slowly and slowly we see that the way these bills are, the direct the first response of the farmers or the peasant was that we all know that in a Punjab we have a well net, though Punjab is just 1.5% of the total area. We have about 2.5% of the total population. But we see that the level of the peasantry, though literacy rate is not that much of high, but the political mobilization of the peasant is very much there on the scene. And they have the memories of very successful movement. Even we start from that, the Kuka movement, then we have the Pagdi Sambhal movement, then after that, the Gadar movement was there. Kisan movement was, many, many more movements, the Parja Mandal movement was very much there. After that, in the Green Revolution, with the rise of this farmers organization, particularly of the farmer unions, they have mobilized the people many times to put pressure on the government for the achievement of their certain goals, or to put the pressure on the government to fulfill their demands in that years. So in this way, the farmers were very clear from that day. So that this ordinance was implemented, the protest movement started, the farmers raised their voice against these policies and the law, this ordinance also over there. They know that this is going to be, what we see is that giving a free hand to the multinational corporations, or even to the Indian corporation, in the sense that the ultimate aim is that to take away their livelihood, in the sense that India, we have seen that in a pandemic, all business, all other activities came to standstill. It was the agriculture. I do not know why the government has not taken into that consideration कि इवन द वेरी इकोनॉमिक ग्रोथ ऑफ दिस कंट्री वाज बेस्ड ऑन द एग्रीकल्चर ग्रोथ ओवर देयर. देयर वाज अ टोटल स्टैंड स्टिल ऑल अदर इकोनॉमिक एक्टिविटीज, द बिजनेस एक्टिविटीज, द सर्विस एक्टिविटीज, लार्ज स्केल ले ऑफ वाज देयर. रीजन बीइंग इज दैट वी हैव अ वेरी लिमिटेड सोशल सिक्योरिटी इन द सेंस दैट मोर देन 90% ऑफ द पीपल आर वर्किंग इन द unorganized sector. In the unorganized sector, there is hardly any security of the job or the security of the employment is there. Only 10% population is in the formal sector. So it was only the agriculture which came to the rescue of what we see is that what happened in case of this development. Second thing was that the farmers were very much clear. We have the best example of what is being given by them is that it was firstly the Bihar which abolished the agriculture marketing over there 2006. And we all know that, and we are also surprised that for the last 10-15 years, Punjab, the area under cultivation, Punjab and Haryana is coming down because of industrialization, because of the urbanization, but the yield or the production is increasing. Now they have come to know that that the crop is basically the food grains are being bought from the Bihar or the Eastern UP, and these are being sold in Punjab because it was only in case of a Punjab and a Haryana where the minimum support price is here. So in this way, the slowly and this distance ultimately became a very powerful or a very strong movement over there, and this all became possible when the farmers started moving. Firstly, they have a dharna outside on the roads. They blocked the roads over there. And after that, they started having that small groups over there. And ultimately, it became what is called as a people's movement in the sense that firstly, it was from the farmers of the Punjab. Slowly and slowly, Haryana came into being. The Western UP came into being. And it was not only confined to the farmers also, because slowly and slowly the people of the countryside or other non-agriculture communities and the classes came to know that in case agriculture gets controlled by the big farmers, the multinational farmers, the survival of the very large section of the society, particularly those who are work in the informal sector, you have the redi walas, you have the padi walas, the small shopkeepers in the countryside, they are going to be affected. So slowly and slowly they started joining this movement, and ultimately it started increasing its influence. And the most important thing which you have seen that ultimately this farmers movement, this farmers agitations has crossed all the limits, not limits which was created by the state and the system over there, the limits which were already there, particularly in the case of the social stratification. So it's not only confined to one caste also, it's not only confined to one religion also, it's not confined to one regions also. The important thing of this movement is that, or impact of this movement will be, I think, the felt in the times to come, and which is going to make its impact very clear in the coming days, political system or a political process or political culture or the culture of the is that it helped to have a sort of at the moment a very strong, very grounded, very grassroots level a working unity among the people representing the various categories, representing the various segments of the society over there. So in this way, we have seen that people came forward at their own. We are basically witnessing all these movements. We are witnessing the peasants' issues over there, some other rallies over there, since we have worked among the farmers. It was quite difficult to ask the people to come and to for a rally or a dharna or a demonstration or sometime going to Chandigarh or Delhi and so forth. I think this is for the first time which we are witnessing that people are coming at their own and joining the movement. They are not coming at their own, they are contributing whatever they can contribute. We have seen the village has become a unit. Even in the village, a mohalla has become a unit. And in some cases, it becomes a sort of a competition within a village. That's why, but I'm saying the structure of this resistance, structure of this movement against these three laws is that it's a voluntary participation. It's not involuntary in the sense that people are coming at their own. And it's not only that only the peasantry is coming. It's not only that only the aged are coming. or middle aged are coming, the young are coming, the women are coming, all are coming at their own to be part of this movement, to part of this protest, to part of this resistance. I will call it this movement is a sort of a resistance from the below. And this resistance of the below has become a symbol of the strength of this movement. So that's why this movement has, we're again facing a very serious situation in the country because of the second wave. But because of that, the movement is going for the last more than 8 months, and it's going on. And day after day, it's going to, we are sustaining it. It's a continuing. It's almost getting strengthened in that way also. So that's why it became a people's movement, because it's based on will of the people. It's a voluntary association, and it is for the first time that this type of development has taken place where the people are joining at their own and participating and supporting the movement, not only going to the Delhi and the borders of the Delhi, but going to the district headquarters, the Tehsil headquarters, even in the villages, whenever there are any. What we see is that the call is given, they become part of that. Because if you see the very structure of this movement or structure of this resistance, particularly there's an n number of organizations are there. The total number of the farmers organizations is about 500. But we are witnessing that the Punjab is taking lead in this movement, and almost all the state organizations, the state associations, they have recognized the role of the peasants of the Punjab, the peasant leaders of the Punjab. So they have made now what we call is a Sardar jede hai gaya, movement de ohi hai gaya, and they are just following them. And the way they have organized themselves while having interaction with the government, because the government concern was that government was in that what we see Gulf famine, that farmers are not articulate. The farmers are not that much of what we see is that they have so many basically things in their mind. Okay, they are non-articulate, they do not know, they cannot argue with the high profile officials of the government. But we have seen that the maturity of the farmers, the way they have organized themselves, that the way they have a consensus, the way they are discussing things in a very minute way, and the way they interact with each other, and they are commanding their groups over there. So ultimately, they have shown not to the government, not to the people, but even their followers, that this movement or this peasant movement is in the safe hand. Because we know that government has so many tricks. All governments do all basically type of the dirty things, and this government has also done. Many challenges were created, many issues were created, many things were created, many instruments they used to bring a sort of a disunity among the farmers over there. And we all know that this has not happened. We have seen that there are 11 talks are there with the high profile official of the government. Every time we have come to know that the farmers are more articulate, the farmers are more argumentative, and they basically they pushed back the government officials on that issue, because they had the facts they have, the arguments they have, everything is with them. The reason being is that a lot of literature, lot of writings by the scholars, by the social scientists, by the scientists, by the economists, and even by the other segment of the societies, particularly in this, the role of one paper that is of the Punjabi Tribune is very much there. If you go by the writings in the Punjabi Tribune, they have a thread where discussed all the movements, historical movements, and particularly of this movement, various aspects, ifs and buts of the movement, and clearly based on various issues and the facts, which ultimately put the government on the back track. So point here is that when we see this movement, it's not it has not come from the above, it is from the below. And that is the major success of this movement, and it is surviving and it is sustaining, and possibly it will take the things into the logical end. The second thing is what we see, that support it got from not only from India, the support of the diaspora is very much there. We have seen that the way the Punjabi diaspora particularly, or the others, the way, Vitti, Zoya, the phone out there. the way it got sport of all kinds. It got what we see is that the modernity sport is there. It got moral sport is very much there. All types of sport is there. And the whole issue got highlighted at various platforms, at various forums. And in many cases, they try to prevail upon their legislators to raise this house there. That also became one of the strengths which gave. The second is that the role of the religious and other social organizations and all other segments of the society, which ultimately even the single, even the artist, even some small businessmen, they came to the support of this farmers' movement. Had it been not there, it would have been very difficult to sustain this movement. So in this way, this movement, the peasants' movement, got support from all segments of the society. The reason being is that they put their argument in a very logical way. They came up with the facts and figures. They have an explanatory. Basically, the power is very much there. So they are explaining that they are not fighting their survival. They are not fighting their own war. They are fighting the nation's war. They are fighting the struggle of all the marginalized section of the society. And possibly, this is for the first time that this movement has become a rallying point, which is very important, particularly if we see it from the secular perspective. When you see it from an occupational perspective, when we see it a movement which is has impact across the regions, because we know that now the leadership, most of the farmer organization is leadership with the in the hands of the young farmers, and these young farmers are literate. The young farmers are, as I said, that they articulate, and they are almost free from that type of ego which is there. So in this way, this movement also posed the various challenges to the system, particularly of the Indian system, particularly of the present dispensation, which is used to have not heard basically any resistance, which has not heard any no from any segment of the society. We all know that what type of politics we have. For the last 2-3 years, 4 years, we have seen that a lot of many controversial other laws were passed. They just pushed in, just implemented without any, what we see is that discussion without any resistance from any side. So possibly this movement is emerging as a serious challenge to the existing dispensation. This movement is emerging as a serious challenge of the people's powers to the present dispensation, in the sense that it's challenging the very structure of the decision making. It's challenging the very nature of the way decisions are being taken over here. It's challenging the very might of the power in a very democratic way, in a very peaceful way. This is another interesting example of the peasants' movement. We have seen various other peasant movements over there. And this is the only peasant movement you see that fully peaceful, fully democratic, fully, voluntary, fully cooperative. And in this, which the large percentage of the women participation is a very illustrating example of this movement, not only from Punjab, but even from the Haryana, which is considered to be a society which is a little bit traditional in that way also, or in a Western UP or some other parts of the country over there. So in this way, it's giving a new dimension to the politics in the days to come. It seems to us basically, we're not that much of optimist, but definitely this movement is going to show a new path, a new way to the democratic process, or a political process, or a dynamics of a social process in the times to come in that way also. Because one thing is that a new phenomena, we are basically witnessing that since Haryana came into existence for the last more than 55 years, everything we've heard about the Punjab and Haryana is about their conflicts. The water dispute is there, territorial dispute is there, yeah, capital, and so on and so forth, Jat or non-Jat, and so on and so forth. And this is for the first time we have seen that a new type of unity has come. In spite of the efforts of the government of Haryana to make some controversial issue, to bring those issues into this struggle, the people of the Haryana outrightly rejected all these, what we see is that the issues raised by the government or the MLAs over there. So in this way, it's giving us a new hope. It's giving us a, it's showing us a new path. It's showing us a new future, in the sense that if people remain united, if they can come basically united on certain issues, which are common issues, which is common to all, or the secular issue, there's a possibility of it is that, because we have seen that even by me, visited that these three borders over there, we talked to the people. One thing it was that the people who could not move out of the of their villages for the whole life, or they went up to the district headquarters, those who are sitting there in a Delhi border for 10 days, 15 days, 30 days, or some even 2-3 months, they have become political. This farmers' movement has made a large segment of the people are political. They are raising the issues, they are raising the questions, they are having, they're interacting with each other, they're discussing the issues which they face, even in their village or even their houses, or the politics of the country in that way also. So what I think is that this farmer movement, blessing in disguise, is that it made large number of the people political, which are not political. I'm not saying that it's going to totally change that the whole scenario over there, but it's going to have a big, what we see is that the good beginning in this situation over there. So in this way, they could raise that slogan, because everybody talks about, we know that after 70s, particularly of the Chaudhary Charan Singh, the politics was being on the basis of the farmers. Farmers became a central issue. It was clear. Everybody claimed to be a farmer. I think possibly it was a Janata Party with at that time where this issue was there, okay, that we should focus on the welfare of the people living in the countryside. So they claimed to be a farmer. They pretended to be a farmer, but the whole politics was being appropriated on the name of the farmers, on the name of the villages, and so on and so forth. This is for the first time that the farmers' movement has brought the core issues of the peasantry. And they realize the people that whatever you eat in the morning for your survival, it's being produced, it's being by the farmers. The very concept of Andhra, my point here is that the underlining of the very meaning or very importance of being a farmer, that became, that's why it became a household name. You see the slogans, no farmers, no food, no farmers, no life, no farmers, no survival. So it has become, what we see is that the central point. And in this way, in this process, farmers at least would reinforce the very importance of being a farmer, or very importance of farmer being what we see is that andata of that the population over there. Another thing was that the way they registered, particularly I shouldn't that one or me, is that it exposed the communal and the fascist tendency of the ruling party, particularly of the pseudo-nationalist agenda of the RSS BJP. This example we can see very much in the Western UP. We have 12, 13 districts of the Western UP where that experiment of communalism was made in the 2013, there was a Muzaffarpur riot. And we see that in the last elections, in a 2019 election and 2014 election of the national parliament and the 2017 election, the way the other issue was created, the Muslims were marginalized. In these 12 districts, almost 40 to 50% population is of the minority community. The way the minority community was sidelined, the way all other was brought under the single umbrella of what is called as the Hindu in that way also, Jat versus the Muslims and the Hindus versus the Muslim. And this movement ultimately, but I think is that the nexus brought that the situation, the structure which they created over there, we see that. Particularly, then quote some examples over there. This one district is a Bijnor, which has more than 50% population of the Muslim is there. The last Kisan election, Kisan Panchayat took place there in 1985, and Mahinder Singh Takayat was the president of the Bharatiya Kisan Union. After that, we know that there's a history of the human rights of there. There was a Kha Panchayat were there. There was a Muslim Panchayat was there. There was Jat Panchayat was there. There was a Saini Panchayat was there. But this is 2021. This is for the first time after many years, more than 36 years, that the Kisan Panchayat, in which all caste and communities basically became a part of that, and a major rally took place over there. So my point here is that this movement basically ultimately again emerged as a challenge of the divisive policies being played by this government. And how much time I have? Yeah, I'm similar. The other example we can give here is that it's sort of a new awakening. We are witnessing that this movement, of course, it's still going on. It is possibly, we have many examples that what we have read that the Pagdi Samaj Jatta movement, that though it was a localized movement, it was there for 8-9 months was there. But this movement is almost completing, next year is completing 1 year. It may go another 5, 6, 4. We do not know how long it will be there. But this movement has brought a sort of a new political awakening among what we see is that the rural people in general and the peasantry in particular. This is also going to be a very important issue in the times to come. But we have seen that the way farmers, particularly the farmer leaders, went to the different parts of the country. They went to West Bengal. Tomorrow results are coming. We do not know what is going to happen over there, but they made this issue over there. They went to Assam. They went to many other states over there. And the farmers of the various other states came to Delhi. Though we have, there's still restriction on the movements of the trains over there. All farmers cannot come to Delhi because they have to cover a lot of distance over there. But the farmers from Maharashtra, farmers from Gujarat, Rajasthan, they all got united over there on the borders. So it's sort of a new political awakening, a political awareness, and a sort of a unity that is one of the major contribution of this farmers movement. Or in this movement, we have seen that the farmers found their own ways, particularly the role of, I would like to mention that the role of the played by the young fighters in the farmers movements who invented their own ways to disseminate the information, to give the information of what is going in this movement. We know that what is the role of the media. Media, particularly in case of India, is still is under criticism, except one or two houses. All the medias, they're not performing their role which they are supposed to perform. So they found their own way. They use the social media platform. They have the Instagram is there. They came up with their own publications. Trolley Time is there. The way they disseminate the whole information, the way they use it as a source of communication. Communication is not only between and among the leaders. Communication between and among the large segment of the society or the masses, starting from the village to the people sitting in Delhi. So my point here is that this farmers movement, sir, particularly which is still going on there, it is sort of a different type of political awakening. They're raising the issue. They're raising the questions. They are participating in that discussion. We have seen that it's not only what is going only at the Delhi border. Every day, if we leave for the last 10, 15, 20 days, these things are not taking place. Before that, Every third day, we have a small rally in the villages. We have small, what is the protest in the city. We have a regular meetings even in the cities, particularly in the urban areas. We have seen that in Chandigarh, a large number of people, they do assemble on the various circles in the evening. They just raise the issues. They have a flags in their houses, their hands. They just have a sympathy with the ongoing peasants movements over there. My point here is that. So in this way, ultimately, the way people get more politicized, the way people get more awakened, the way people get more, what we see that they're raising the issue. So that's why what we are witnessing over here is that all political parties or all the leaders of the political party, they are in a very confused state of mind to what answer they will give to the people in the coming elections. We all know that the role of political parties, particularly in case of the Punjab, either it may be a party or B party, maybe a Akali or the Congressi, people have basically come to know that all were involved in this situation over there. All were basically part and parcel, all had that support to this law. And initially, all were against the peasants movement. They tried to basically convince the farmers. Ultimately, it was the farmers who forced them, firstly, one party to resign from the central government to take its support back. And on the other side, they forced the Congress government, ruling government in the state to come not to oppose or not to take any action against the farmers over there. So I think this defenseless on the part of the ruling government and the principal party ultimately brought a sense of understanding among the common masses that if people gets united on a common cause, then they can achieve, they can have what they wanted to have. And they know that this farmers' movement has given this situation and the platform to bring all segment of the people into one platform. I think I should stop here if you have any questions.
Yeah, thank you, Dr. Sekhar. I think very aptly done, and really appreciate the time you've given us. Since we don't have too much time because of the initial delay, we're going to take questions from the audience. So I'll get right to that. The first question we have is from Star Bajinder Singh. And if you can, he's already unmuted. So please go ahead, Star Bajinder Singh, you can ask a question.
Professor Sekhon, Wahegur Khalsa, Wahegur Fateh.
Ji.
I have listened to you very keenly. What you have described is the past. We in the diaspora, Punjabi diaspora, we are live with India, what's happening. We are live with what's happening with the Morchas. We are live what Modi is doing. We are live with the Punjab government is doing. So we are completely updated within few hours of what the events are happening there. So with due respect, you have taken a detail about the past. So what I was expecting from you is the agrarian issues arising out of the future. Now, where are we going to go? The farmers are sitting there for months. So I was hoping that the intellectual groups, professors, the other people in the society with the intellectual portion of the study, they will get together and they will form some kind of a group to pressure the government and the ministers and all that. Because farmers are sitting there for months. So where do we go? It's a stalemate. So, and on the top of it, to make it worse, there is no place they can go. The courts are already compromised. And all the institutions are already compromised. So what is your opinion about moving forward from this point onwards?
Thank you, Sabajinder Singh.
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much. You have raised very pertinent issue. And I know that those who are concerned about Punjab, they are all are basically aware of what is happening over there. Right? In this way, I will start from that. What is the way out? The way out is that the pressure from the below. When I use the word pressure from the below, pressure from the masses, pressure from the people, we have to sustain it. We have to continue it. We have to strengthen it. And ultimately, things have reached to that level that now the peasantry have nothing to lose, except you see that what they are facing now, in the sense that agriculture, this present model of agriculture is non-sustainable. Survival on agriculture is very difficult, and you see that in Punjab, what is happening, the way it's very difficult to say this thing. If we ask this question to the people, nobody wants to stay in Punjab at this point of time. This is a fact of life. Anyone who gets an opportunity wants to leave Punjab. I do not know why it happened. And one reason is there that because the stakeholders, the problem lies, I will start with that, lies with us, that we could not assert our stakes over here. The reason being is that the whole development process, particularly in Punjab, the Green Revolution, we are facing the consequences of the Green Revolution. The Green Revolution, as I said, that it brought political stability for the country. Green Revolution brought economic growth in the country. Green Revolution gave a new image to the country, but at the cost of the Punjab and the cost of the people of the Punjab. After Green Revolution, the structure of the politics which came to Punjab, power went into the hands of a newly rich class, that the clerk class, representing, unfortunately, belonging to the same caste and the same class. Now we say that we have two political parties, A party and B party.
I'm sorry, Professor. I'm sorry for interrupting. See, your emphasis is still going back onto Green Revolution. I'm looking forward how we can teach the farmer to go for diversify the crops, to form the cooperatives, how they can reduce their debt levels, how they can not borrow money which they cannot pay back. So this is the thing, ideas which we are looking forward from people like you from those positions. Forget about the past. I don't even want to talk about yesterday. I just want to talk about from today, moving onwards. Sorry for interruption, but this is how I feel. I strongly feel that, so that I have come into you while you were saying something. Thank you.
Absolutely right, sir. In the sense that, what is the way out? The question is, what is the way out? Way out, again, lies with the people. We have to have our own solution of the problem, in the sense that, first thing is the structural problem is that, okay, there's a need to have cooperative farming, number one. The second is that government intervention, in the sense that is the technology is very much there to go for what is called as a cash crops. But again, we have many issues over there. Government has raised its hand in that way also. You know that what is the situation of the Punjab Agriculture University. No new techniques in that way is coming there. Then again, the question comes to the, it's with the people over there. And again, the role of what we see is that there's need to have a leadership, in the sense, not I'm talking about the political leadership, leadership from the community, leadership from the within, so that a new path is to be evolved, in the sense that firstly is how to survive, how to go with this, this small land holding. One thing, I will again come to that level. Cultural change transformation is the must, in the sense that you also know that now we have a lords without land. How to change that mindset? There's a need to change the mindset. There's a need to move from that traditional crop pattern to the modern. But here we need 80%. What the economists say that the peasantry is under the debt. They do not have the resources. They do not have that access to the resources. So someone is to come into. role of the government is very much there. The responsibility of the government is very much there. Responsibility of the philanthropist is very much there. We have a good tradition of the role of sometimes the some babas, some karseva wadis are there. They can mobilize the people on those lines. There's a need to have change in the mindset of the people. And for that, there's a need, a major initiative is required. That's a major question. Who will bell that the cat in this situation? So reason being is that at present, I'm saying that when hardly you ask anyone, people have, what they think is that when it's sort of, I'm sorry to say this is a very strong word, I do not want to use that. There's a crisis of sense of belonging. There's a crisis of being a part of this development process. So once this thing is not there, we cannot force people to do this. There's a need to, what we see that involve inculcate that thought process so that they are moved, they are convinced. And in this situation, again, I'm coming to that, the role of the institution is very much there. The role of the system is very much there. The role of the political class is also very much there. The role of the government is very much there. The first thing is that there's a need to, you know, Punjabi humbla marna, saariyan di lod hai ki inu humbla maran di. Aur ohde layi pehli gal te hai ga, ki eh cheez ton ke jadi saadi sense of insecurity in spite of sara kuch saade kol hai ga. Our colleagues in the other parts of the country says when they listen ke bacche bahar nu ja rahe ya itthe rehnda koi nahi ga, oh kehnde yaar tade ko ki nahi hai ga kuch, Odisha ch ki hai ga, Bihar ch ki hai ga, क्यों लोग नहीं रह रहे, तुहाडे को पानी भी आ, तुहाडे को जमीन भी हैगी आ, तुहाडे को सारा कुछ हैगा वा, ये जरा क्वेश्चन साडे तों सबसे वड्डा क्वेश्चन ये हैगा कि असीं क्यों इन्ने इनसिक्योर होई जाने आ, क्यों इन्ने असीं जिहड़े हैगे आ ये साडा जिहड़ा दिल नहीं लग रिहा उचाट होया वा, उहदे वी रीजन लभण दी लोड हैगी नाल नाल, ते नाल नाल ये भी हैगा कि इस तरीके दी जिहड़ी मोटिवेशन हैगी आ, इस तरीके दा जिहड़ा इनिशिएटिव हैगा। हाँ, प्रॉब्लम फिर वड्डी सीरियस हैगी। मैं जस्ट गिव यू वन एग्जांपल, Pakistani Punjab has a severe shortage of the food grains. They need about 5 million tons of the wheat over there. They need many million tons of the sugar cane over there. Sadi samasya hai ki we being a border state, sadi unna relations bahut kharab hai. We suffered a lot because of the wars, being a border state. It was a India-Pakistan war, but it was a Punjab which suffered. 60% of the area in the Punjab is the border belt. And that border belt of Punjab, when we go to that area, it seems to us that it's not a part of Punjab. So it's not a simple, sir, in that way also. There are multiple issues, there are multiple questions, and there's a need to have a multiple approach from all sides, from all corners. Everybody should be part of that stakeholder. Yes, it is there that intellectual role is very much there. Everybody has a role. Diaspora has a role. They're performing their role. Intellectual are also performing a role, but they need to have a big push so that at least that sense of belonging is inculcated, that trust that this area belongs to us, this Punjab belongs to us, this land belongs to the gurus and the peace, everything. I think that that issue, once we are in a position to undone that thought process, then it will be easy for us to move forward or to think about what as you have raised this issue.
Thank you, Professor Seiko. I think it's very challenging and it is a complex issue and it's not an easy question to answer, but I appreciate your thoughts on that. Is there anybody else who has a question? We've got Sir Kripal Singh Ji. Could you unmute, please, and go ahead and ask a question? Go ahead.
Dr. Seiko, I'm ਜਿਹੜੀ ਤੁਸੀਂ ਪ੍ਰੈਜੈਂਟੇਸ਼ਨ ਦਿੱਤੀ ਬਹੁਤ ਸੋਹਣੀ। ਭਾਈ ਸਾਹਿਬ, ਕੁਐਸਚਨ ਇਹ ਹੈਗਾ ਕਿ ਆਪਾਂ ਦੀ ਅਕੈਡਮਿਕ ਸਰਕਲਸ ਆਪਣੀ ਸਟੇਟ ਦੇ ਜਾਂ ਆਪਣੀ ਕੰਟਰੀ ਦੇ, ਹਾਊ ਡਿਡ ਦੇ ਮਿਸ ਦਿਸ ਹੋਲ ਥਿੰਗ? ਇਹ ਕਿਸੇ ਨੇ ਵੀ ਇਹ ਰੀਅਲਾਈਜ਼ ਨਹੀਂ ਕੀਤਾ ਕਿ ਇਦਾਂ ਦੀ ਫਿਊਚਰ ਦੇ ਵਿੱਚ ਡਿਵੈਲਪਮੈਂਟ ਹੋ ਜਾਊਗੀ, ਤੇ ਕਾਹਤੇ ਸਾਰੇ ਜਣੇ ਚੁੱਪ ਕਰਕੇ ਬੈਠੇ ਰਹੇ? ਉਹਦਾ ਮਤਲਬ ਬੇਸਿਕ ਰੀਜ਼ਨ ਕੀ ਹੋ ਸਕਦਾ ਆ ਜਿਹਦੇ ਕਿ ਜਿਹੜਾ ਕਿ ਅਸੀਂ ਇਹਦੇ ਤੋਂ ਲਰਨ ਕਰੀਏ, ਕਿਉਂਕਿ ਡੈਫੀਨੇਟਲੀ ਇਹ ਇੱਕ ਦਿਨ 'ਚ ਤਾਂ ਇਹ ਚੀਜ਼ ਡਿਵੈਲਪ ਨਹੀਂ ਹੋਈ। ਕਿਉਂਕਿ ਜਿਸ ਤਰ੍ਹਾਂ ਹੁਣ ਮੈਂ ਫਿਰ ਪੰਜਾਬੀ ਚ ਲਾਪਿਆ ਫਾਰ ਦੀ ਇੰਗਲਿਸ਼ ਸਪੀਕਿੰਗ ਪੀਪਲ ਯੂ ਸੀ ਦਟ ਥਿੰਗ ਦੈਟ ਵੀ ਹੈਵ ਮਿਸਡ ਇਜ਼ ਦੈਟ ਵੀ ਹੈਵ ਨਾਟ ਬੀਨ ਏਬਲ ਟੂ ਫਾਈਟ ਦਾ ਕਾਇੰਡ ਆਫ ਸੈਂਟਰਲਾਈਜੇਸ਼ਨ ਆਫ ਪਾਵਰ ਦੈਟ ਹੈਜ਼ ਬੀਨ ਹੈਪਨਿੰਗ ਇਨ ਇੰਡੀਆ ਬਿਕੋਜ਼ ਓਰੀਜਨਲ ਕਾਨਸੈਪਟ ਇਜ਼ ਦ ਡੀਸੈਂਟਰਲਾਈਜ਼ਡ ਪਾਵਰ ਪਾਵਰ ਆਫ ਦ ਸਟੇਟਸ ਐਂਡ ਦੀ ਕੰਟਰੀ ਟੂਗੈਦਰ ਬਟ ਵਟ ਵੀ ਆਰ ਲੁਕਿੰਗ ਐਟ ਇਜ਼ ਦੈਟ ਦੀ ਸੈਂਟਰ ਇਜ਼ ਸਨੈਚਿੰਗ ਅਵੇ ਈਚ ਐਂਡ ਐਵਰੀ ਪਾਵਰ ਦੈਟ ਦ ਸਟੇਟਸ ਹੈਵ ਐਂਡ ਦ ਹੋਲ ਥਿੰਗ ਇਜ਼ ਰੀਲੀ ਗੈਟਿੰਗ ਬੇਸਡ ਅਪੋਨ ਚਮਚਾਗਿਰੀ ਕਾਇੰਡ ਆਫ ਮਾਡਲ ਐਂਡ ਦੀ ਇੰਟੈਲੀਜੈਂਸੀਆ ਇਨ ਦ Is it that in the universities and in the colleges, in the higher education, that we are not discussing these kind of issues from that point of view and let these kind of politicians, you know, for example, in this issue, what I'm observing is Amrinder Singh Hooni kehnde ji fulana jana gaya si oh dastkhat karya hai, tingda jana gaya oh dastkhat karya hai. Galat hai gaya ke oh dastkhat edan bagair kise debate de, without any debate, how those kind of signatures happened. Afterthought de vich ta matlab everybody is trying to blame each and other. So my question is, you being in the academic circles, what kind of steps needs to be taken so that in future we do not commit that mistake and hold the thing together? So that's basically what my question is. Thank you very much.
Dr. Pasanji, thank you. Dr. Seiko, just please be cognizant of the fact we have literally less than 3 minutes. So yeah, you keep it short because I don't want our meeting to get over by itself. So thank you.
Yeah. Go ahead. Yeah. Sir, pehli galat hai ki the whole structure of the Indian Union is that it was not a federal system. It's a union of states. States were created by the union. Unlike in case of the United States of America, where the states created the union. One. The second is that you see that all over the world, this development process, do teen cheezan hai giyan jinna ne sari centralization process lenda. ਇੱਕ ਤਾਂ ਹੈਗਾ ਕਿ ਜਿਹੜਾ ਖਾਸ ਕਰਕੇ ਟ੍ਰੇਡ ਹੈਗਾ ਸਾਰਾ ਸੈਂਟਰਲ ਗਵਰਨਮੈਂਟ ਦੇ ਕੋਲ ਹੈਗਾ ਰੈਵਨਿਊ ਉਹਦੇ ਕੋਲ ਜਾਂਦਾ ਹੈ ਕਮਿਊਨੀਕੇਸ਼ਨ ਆ ਗਿਆ ਟਰਾਂਸਪੋਰਟੇਸ਼ਨ ਆ ਗਈ ਦਿਸ ਇਜ਼ ਵਟ ਹੈਜ਼ ਹੈਪਨ ਇਨ ਦੈਟ ਵੇ ਆਲਸੋ ਤਾਂ ਸੈਂਟਰਲਾਈਜੇਸ਼ਨ ਦਾ ਪ੍ਰੋਸੈਸ ਜਿਹੜਾ ਵਾ ਕੰਟੀਨਿਊਸਲੀ ਆਲ ਓਵਰ ਦਾ ਵਰਲਡ ਇਟ ਇਜ਼ ਵੈਰੀ ਮੱਚ ਦੇਅਰ ਪਰਟੀਕੁਲਰਲੀ ਮੋਰ ਇਨ ਦਾ ਸਾਡੇ ਵਰਗੇ ਦੇਸ਼ਾਂ ਦੇ ਵਿੱਚ ਬਹੁਤ ਜ਼ਿਆਦਾ ਹੈਗਾ ਔਰ ਖਾਸ ਕਰਕੇ ਇਹ ਸਾਡੀ ਜਿਹੜੀ ਖਾਸ ਰੀਜਨਲ ਲੀਡਰਸ਼ਿਪ ਕਾਂਗਰਸ ਰਹੀ ਲੰਮਾ ਸਮਾਂ ਆਈ ਡੋ ਨਾਟ ਵਾਂਟ ਟੂ ਗੋ ਇਨ ਟੂ ਦੈਟ ਪਾਸਟ ਤੋਂ ਲੰਬੀ ਤੁਸੀਂ ਸਾਰੇ ਜਾਣਦੇ ਜੋ ਹੁਣ ਵਟ ਇਜ਼ ਦ ਵੇ ਆਊਟ Intellectuals are playing their role. We intelligentsia is playing role. Punjab, India, the which, khas karke resistance hai ki ya. You see that Bhima, Koregaon, gaon hai, JNU issues there. Even Sade bhi hai ka siya. Sari university the intellectuals are all are resisting the nefarious the designs hai ka si. Indira Gandhi nu karte si ge, baaj bhi karte si, hun bhi karte si, sara kuch kar diya. It's going on. But the whole development process jada sada, jada jis kisam da process ho raha, is centralization ho rahi hai. Unfortunately part eh hai ga ke sade varge desh de vich ਪਾਵਰ ਦੀ ਸੈਂਟਰਲਾਈਜੇਸ਼ਨ ਹੋ ਰਹੀ ਆ ਜਿਹੜਾ ਦਹਿਸ਼ਤ ਹੈਗੀ ਆ ਟੈਰਰਿਜ਼ਮ ਹੈਗਾ ਵਾ ਜਾਂ ਜਿਹੜਾ ਤੁਹਾਡਾ ਧੱਕਾ ਹੈਗਾ ਉਹਦੀ ਡੀਸੈਂਟਰਲਾਈਜੇਸ਼ਨ ਹੋ ਰਹੀ ਆ ਸਾਰੇ ਥਾਂ ਤੇ ਉਹਨੂੰ ਖਿਲਾਰਿਆ ਜਾ ਰਿਹਾ ਤਾਕਤ ਇੱਕ ਪਾਸੇ ਵੱਲ ਜਾ ਰਹੀ ਆ ਔਰ ਇਹ ਜ਼ਿਆਦਾਤਰ ਖਾਸ ਕਰਕੇ ਫਾਰ ਦਾ ਲਾਸਟ 7-6-7 ਈਅਰਸ ਦੇ ਵਿੱਚ ਇਟ ਹੈਜ਼ ਇਨਕਰੀਸਡ ਅ ਮੈਨੀਫੋਲਡ ਸੈਕੰਡ ਥਿੰਗ ਇਜ਼ ਦੈਟ ਯੂ ਹੈਵ ਟੂ ਸੀ ਦੈਟ ਮੈਂ ਫਿਰ ਉਹੀ ਗੱਲ ਕਹੂੰਗਾ ਕਿ ਜਿਹੜਾ ਕਲਾਸ ਕਰੈਕਟਰ ਹੈਗਾ ਰੂਲਿੰਗ ਅਲੀਟ ਦਾ ਚਾਹੇ ਉਹ ਸਟੇਟ ਦੀ ਹੈਗੀ ਆ ਚਾਹੇ ਸੈਂਟਰ ਦੀ ਹੈਗੀ ਆ ਇਹ ਇਹਨੂੰ ਸਮਝਣ ਦੀ ਬਹੁਤ ਲੋੜ ਹੈਗੀ ਆ ਤੁਸੀਂ ਐਗਜ਼ਾਮਪਲ ਦਿੱਤੀ ਆ ਅਮਰਿੰਦਰ ਸਿੰਘ ਦੀ ਕੀਤੀ ਆ ਬਾਦਲ ਸਾਹਿਬ ਦੀ ਦਿੱਤੀ ਆ ਦੇ ਆਰ ਨਾਟ ਪਾਰਟ ਆਫ ਏ ਮਾਸਿਸ ਤੋਂ ਉਹ ਪਾਰਟ ਹੈ ਹੀ ਨਹੀਂ ਗੇ ਉਹ ਤਾਂ ਪਾਵਰ ਸਟਰਕਚਰ ਦਾ ਹਿੱਸਾ ਬਣ ਕੇ ਬਹਿ ਗਏ ਉਹਦੇ ਵਿੱਚ ਉਹਨਾਂ ਨੂੰ ਮਿਲਦੇ ਆ ਸਾਰਾ ਕੁਝ ਉਹ ਚ ਮਿਲਦੇ ਆ ਲੋਕ ਉਹਨਾਂ ਦੇ ਏਜੰਡੇ ਦੇ ਵਿੱਚ ਨਹੀਂ ਸੀਗਾ ਦੋ ਚੀਜ਼ਾਂ ਹੁੰਦੀਆਂ ਕੋਈ ਵੀ ਤਬਦੀਲੀ ਲਿਆਉਣ ਵਾਸਤੇ ਜਾਂ ਤਾਂ ਜਿਹੜੀ ਸੈਂਟਰ ਹੈਗੀ ਆ ਉਹ ਬਹੁਤ ਠੀਕ ਠਾਕ ਹੋਵੇ ਗੁੱਡ ਲਾਸ ਆਰ ਬੀਂਗ ਇਨੈਕਟਡ ਇੰਪਲੀਮੈਂਟਡ ਵਿਦ ਅ ਸੰਸੀਅਰ ਜਾਂ ਦੇਰ ਇਜ਼ ਅ ਪ੍ਰੈਸ਼ਰ ਫਰੋਮ ਦਾ ਬਿਲੋ We have seen that the pressure from the below was limited. Punjab bahut choti state hai. We have a limited number of member parliament. You know that the way Punjab got divided, firstly 47, then 66. And now we have only, what we see is that 13 MPs. This government has nothing to do with that. I think it's very clear on the part of this government. Punjab de sare MP jande sanu koi bother nahi karde. But they do not know the history of Punjab. They do not know the contribution of the people of the Punjab. My point here is that only thing is that people get united. People get united only when you have a common issue, when you have a secular issue, when you have an issue which are related to the roti rozi. And that's why this peasant movement, again, I will say that has provided a golden opportunity to all the stakeholders, be the farmers, be the intellectual, be the unionists, be the employees, be the women, which raise that issue, which will serve many concerns. The first is that to focus on the people issue. And the second is that to resist the what is called as the centralized policies, the way the laws were enacted, expose the very structure of the functioning of the system. I think this is a sort of a long struggle. This is a sort of a, what we see is that a long resistance, which we all have to sustain for a longer period till the issue is resolved. It's not even that these three laws are being taken back, that peasantry is the problem of the peasantry are not coming to an end. There are mounting issues before the peasantry. So we have to go beyond that. We can say that these laws are at the moment on the deathbed. We only want a certificate from the government, but we have to go beyond that. And once we move all unitedly, collectively, ultimately the issues are which has raised, and the role of the intellectual intelligentsia is very much important in this struggle or in this movement. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Dr. Seiko. I think we're running out of time, so I'm sorry we may not be able to take more questions unless someone's got some comment. Sir Baljinder Singh, do you have a comment? If you can keep it for just 5 seconds, and then we need to wrap up.
Yes, I do have a comment. I think now farmers have done their part on the border, but I'm expecting that, for example, Agriculture University in Ludhiana has an extension department. They go to the villages, they go to the farmers, they advise them, show them. Similarly, Guru Nanak Dev University has professors, and you have some. These professors and the extension department should form a small task force and move village to village to village. So tell them the economic issues, how they can survive on that small piece of land. They can, if they become smart, they go into diversification, control their expenses, and control that. You know, there is a problem in Punjab. We do one-upmanship. Okay, somebody did something, I want to do over that. You know, the expenses on the marriage palaces, expenses on the, they can't afford the tractors, but they have to have a tractor because the neighbor had a tractor. So these are the social economic issues. So I expect that professors and extension departments need to form a task force, go village, every village, and try to talk to the village panchayats and say, hey, our future is bleak. You have no choice. We don't have a choice. That's the reality. So we've got to work on those issues within the state, within the society, within our groups. So that's all I wanted to say. Thank you for all the, you know, presentation you have made, and I appreciate that your time.
Viji, this is just Veerpal.
Hello?
Hello?
Yes, Veerpal, yeah. Go ahead. We may run out of time, so please go ahead quickly.
I just wanted to say to the professor that we enjoyed and we are very thankful to him. But as BG Baljinder Singh said, I would say, what is the one thing he as an intellectual would do to reach out to our beautiful villages in Punjab that are getting ruined now, and how he will mobilize at least his own family or himself to be a part of this movement and organize little steps or organize some meetings where they teach our women or men or young men with love and appreciation, not just, you know, ignoring them or just giving them commands, but at least asking them that we are here for you. And we would like to hear from him what they would do as a group of professors in the near future, as Viji said, to go to the areas where the people of Punjab need to be educated. Of course, they have a lot of courage, they have a lot of energy, they have a lot of time to give, but they need the real direction, which is from the intellectuals. Thank you.
Thank you, Panji Spikorji.
ਹਾਂਜੀ ਸਰ ਮੈਂ ਆਪਣੇ ਦੱਸਣਾ ਚਾਹੁੰਦਾ ਕਿ ਮੈਂ ਤਿੰਨਾਂ ਬਾਰਡਰਾਂ ਦੇ ਉੱਤੇ ਰਹਿ ਕੇ ਆ ਮੈਂ ਮੇਰੀ ਵਾਈਫ ਮੇਰੀ ਸਾਰੀ ਫੈਮਿਲੀ ਯੂਪੀ ਸਾਡਾ ਫਾਰਮ ਹੈਗਾ ਵੈਸਟਰਨ ਯੂਪੀ ਦੇ ਵਿੱਚ ਸਿਟਿੰਗ ਔਨ ਦਾ ਗਾਜ਼ੀਪੁਰ ਬਾਰਡਰ ਵੀ ਆਰ ਮੋਬਿਲਾਈਜ਼ਿੰਗ ਪੀਪਲ ਫਰਮ ਦਾ ਵਿਲੇਜ ਐਵਰੀ ਤੀਹ ਚੌਥੀ ਹੁਣ ਤਾਂ ਨਹੀਂ ਇੱਕ ਹਫ਼ਤੇ ਤੋਂ 4-5 ਦਿਨ ਤੋਂ ਵੀ ਹੈਵ ਮੇਡ ਏ ਸਿਟੀਜ਼ਨ ਫੋਰਮ ਅੰਮ੍ਰਿਤਸਰ ਦੇ ਵਿੱਚ ਆਮ ਕਨਵੀਨਰ ਆਫ ਦੈਟ ਵੀ ਆਰ ਮੋਬਿਲਾਈਜ਼ਿੰਗ ਅਰਬਨ ਪੀਪਲ ਅਸੀਂ ਬਾਰਡਰ ਦੇ ਉੱਤੇ ਬਾਰਡਰ ਏਰੀਆ ਸੰਘਰਸ਼ ਕਮੇਟੀ ਆਈ ਮੈਂਬਰ ਆਫ ਦੈਟ ਆਈ ਡਨ ਟੂ ਮੇਜਰ ਪ੍ਰੋਜੈਕਟਸ ਔਨ ਦ ਪ੍ਰੋਬਲਮਸ ਐਂਡ ਦ ਇਸ਼ੂਸ ਆਫ ਦ ਬਾਰਡਰ ਏਰੀਆ ਵੀ ਮੇਡ ਦੈਟ ਇਸ਼ੂ ਐਟ ਦ ਨੈਸ਼ਨਲ ਲੈਵਲ ਵੀ ਮੇਡ ਦਿਸ ਇਸ਼ੂ ਐਟ ਦ ਗਲੋਬਲ ਲੈਵਲ ਦ ਵੇ ਦਿਸ ਐਨਮਿਟੀ ਬਿਟਵੀਨ ਇੰਡੀਆ ਐਂਡ ਪਾਕਿਸਤਾਨ ਇਜ਼ ਅਲਟੀਮੇਟਲੀ ਕ੍ਰੀਏਟਿੰਗ ਲੋਟ ਆਫ ਪ੍ਰੋਬਲਮ ਲਿਵਿੰਗ ਔਨ ਦ ਬਾਰਡਰ ਵੀ ਆਰ ਮੋਬਲਾਈਜ਼ਿੰਗ people over there. I'm going to all the dharnas, the power stations. I mean, asking the, addressing the farmers, discussing all these issues over there. We all are doing at our own. We are basically doing all types of sport. Monetary sport is there. All type of sport we are doing in this this dharna movement. Not for this dharna, for the last, I think, 30 years. I am part and parcel of the peasants movement, part and parcel of the students movement. I had been to the member of the Guru Nanak Dev University Teacher Council, before that the Students Council over there. So we are trying, whatever our, whichever our capacity is, that we are doing to the best of our capacity, to the best of our understanding, so that this movement, our survival is very much based on this movement. And I'm pretty sure this is the movement which is known as a genuine movement, which came from the below, which people came voluntary. I have not seen in my life for the last 30 years as an active life that the way people are joining this movement. You will be surprised to know that every village is atmanirbhar on even the expenditure. Har pind paise ikatthe karda, apna tractor leke janda, apna sara saman leke janda. It's very interesting. Utthe rehnde aa, wapas aunde aa. Just give you one example. In a UP, ਸਾਡੇ ਫਾਰਮ ਦੇ ਆਲੇ ਦੁਆਲੇ ਸੱਤ ਵੱਡੇ ਪਿੰਡ ਹੈਗੇ ਆ, ਸੱਤਾਂ ਪਿੰਡਾਂ ਦੇ ਵਿੱਚੋਂ ਉਹਨਾਂ ਲੋਕਾਂ ਨੇ ਇੱਕ ਹਫ਼ਤੇ ਵਾਸਤੇ ਜਿਹੜਾ ਹੈਗਾ ਵਾ ਉੱਥੇ ਗਾਜ਼ੀਪੁਰ ਬਾਰਡਰ ਤੇ ਜਾਂਦੇ ਆ. 7 days, seven ਮੈਂਬਰ ਫਰੋਮ ਵਨ ਵਿਲੇਜ, ਦੇ ਆਰ ਵੈਰੀ ਮਚ ਦੇਅਰ. ਆਲ ਟਾਈਪਸ ਆਫ ਸਪੋਰਟ ਇਜ਼ ਬੀਂਗ ਗਿਵਨ ਦੇਅਰ. ਲੋਕਾਂ ਨੇ ਕੋਈ ਮਤਲਬ ਪੀਪਲ ਆਰ ਇੰਜੋਇੰਗ ਦਿਸ ਇਜ਼ ਫਾਰ ਦ ਫਸਟ ਦਿਸ ਨਿਊ ਐਕਸਪੀਰੀਅੰਸ. ਯੂ ਸੀ ਦੈਟ ਕਹਿੰਦੇ ਸੀ ਪੰਜਾਬ ਨਸ਼ੇ ਵਾਲਾ ਹੋ ਗਿਆ, ਪੰਜਾਬ 'ਚੋਂ ਕੁਛ ਨਹੀਂ ਹੋਣਾ. This is a new phenomenon. This is a new hope. This is a new development that the young population, the students, the youth, literate, non-literate, all have become part and parcel of this movement. So that's why when the history of this movement will be written, I think it will be written in a golden words, and it will be remembered in the times to come. I do not know how long it will continue, but I'm pretty sure ultimately it will be the victory of the people over there. And this success of the farmer will give a new dimension to the social, political, economic process in the country. And this made again a Punjab and the Punjabis in the center of the thought process of the rest of the people over there. Punjab again, after a very long time, gained it a lost glory of a different, what we see is that we came with a different names over there, 70s, 80s, and so on and so forth. Again, everybody is looking toward the Punjab, and the histories of the witness, any movement which originated from the Punjab ultimately took to that, to the logical end. I am pretty sure next is it. Rabb di marzi, baki tan ji. Thank you.
Bahut dhanwad ji. Thank you so much.
Okay. Thank you, Dr. Seiko. Is there anybody else who wants to ask our last question? We did have an academic on in the audience. Anybody else? Okay, I don't see any other comments. So without much further ado, I want to thank the entire audience who have been very patient, and especially Dr. Seiko for being here and being our guest. And my sincere apologies for any hiccup to be part of this delay initially. So thank you once again, Dr. Seiko. You've been very good, very patient, and excellent presentation. Thank you. Vaheguru Khalsa, Vaheguru Ki Fateh.